Some have their heads turned to the stars, but strangely enough, mine was glued to the ground. As a child, I was already passionately searching for ancient Greek or Roman potsherds. I was lucky to grow up in Marseille, the oldest city in France, as one of the first cosmopolitan cities, founded in 600 BC by the Greeks coming from Phocea. It is home to vast archaeological treasures. With its port and its colonial past, Marseille is first and foremost an immense window opened onto the sea and beyond. This passion for ceramics has never left me, and it was much later, at the beginning of the 80s, that I found a strange red stoneware teapot on a stand of the flea market. It had a mark stamped in Chinese at its base, probably the name of the potter or maker. I tried to find out everything about this pottery, but unfortunately there were no studies nor any reliable literature on the topic. It was only 2 years later that a more competent antique dealer gave me the first open sesame. It was a Chinese teapot made of Yixing stoneware. Fascinated by this civilization, this answer could only excite my curiosity. I decided to do some research on the origin of this teapot, and above all, try to date it. Was it 50 or 500 years old? Thanks to the pottery, I was about to revive a captivating page of history, the time of the great East Indian companies and of Imperial China. I couldn't imagine at that time how far my investigations would take me. Simonet, a former diplomat and honorary curator of the Chinese collections at the Royal Art and History Museums in Brussels. This providential man, a distinguished sinologist, was the first to encourage me and showed a genuine interest in my research on the Yixing teapots. Damn, I'm completely lost. I was in Hong Kong with my family. I had just arrived, and we had to find some household goods. So we went to some Chinese shops, and that's when I bought a first teapot without knowing that it was a Yixing. When I returned home, I had some tea, and 2 weeks later I went back to the store and I saw another teapot that I purchased for its beauty, and so on and so forth. Each time I went into the shop, I would come back with a new teapot. After that, in Beijing, this continued with increasingly beautiful pieces. I just set myself a price limit. Obviously, this one is really nice, solid, sturdy, with a staggering design. It has a name. It's called Loran, Soutompo's teapot. I think that is the most expensive pot I bought, and there, I went over my own limit. An old teapot produced in Yixing and for European tastes. I really like the cover adjustments on this small teapot. It's like the mechanism of a Leica, no loose parts. A teapot covered with tin, with writing on it, a jade spout, and some inlays. And this one I also like very much. It has the texture of a gourd, or of an object which has remained buried for a long time. It's a technique to texture the surface. And that's the kind of aesthetics the scholars believed in. No color, just the material itself. I think that since Yixing stoneware was very popular with scholars, this boosted the market. And the fact that they ordered these teapots contributed to greater creativity and diversity. This creativity only exists in Chinese arts if the scholar's taste is involved. Later on, this learned man was to introduce me to one of his friends, a native of Yixing, Mr. Zheng Hawa, whose network of acquaintances helped me plan this first trip to China under the best conditions. Faces the Wangpo River and has been left practically unchanged since the 30s. This is where the head offices of the great trading and sea shipping companies were located, alongside the most powerful merchant banks in China. After the communist regime took power, Mao Zedong attempted on many occasions to behead this arrogant symbol of capitalism. But today, Shanghai seems to have become more dazzling and dynamic than in the past, as demonstrated by the incredible vitality of its population and the exuberant creativity of its architecture. Today, the road network has been entirely rearranged, connecting Shanghai to Yixing in only 3 hours. For Yixing, the rejuvenation started at the beginning of the 90s. This busy city has progressively modernized itself and no longer has much to envy the neighboring megalopolis for. If the most populated country in the world is currently celebrating its successful entry into the economy of the third millennium, it's probably because the Chinese rely on the strength and harmony of age-old traditions to build their future. Ding Chuzhen is a must for all amateurs of pottery and teapot. This city, close to Yixing, is entirely dedicated to arts and crafts and to the stoneware industry. Large factories have turned to the production of construction materials, such as bricks, tiles, piping, flower pots of different sizes, and large water or wine jars. Nevertheless, the emblematic product of the region remains the teapot, which made Yixing famous throughout the world. A multitude of small family shops are entirely dedicated to their production. Bold shopkeepers cover entire streets, displaying their models and attracting pottery lovers with an infinite choice of shapes and colors. In the busy Dingchuzhen, stoneware is everywhere, and recycling of materials existed long before it became a trend. Today, walls built from broken or defective objects can still be seen in the old city. By chance, the old residential areas have for the time being survived the frenetic destruction of modern times. They are the last remaining witnesses of a more peaceful ancient China. Yixing enjoys an excellent geographic position. Resting on the shores of the Guanghu, it has always shipped its production by boat, using the river network leading to the Grand Canal. Built by the emperors over a period of almost 8 centuries, the canal connects Anzhou in the south to Beijing in the north over a distance of some 1,800 kilometers. Subsoil is rich, with a high grain size offering unique qualities for the production of teapots. Extracted from open cast quarries or mines, it undergoes meticulous treatment to turn it into stoneware clay before being used by the potter. (laughs)
Voilà, ici nous avons les différentes qualités de roches qu'on peut trouver.
So here we have several varieties of stones from the Yixing region, which give different stoneware colors.
Cette roche va donner du grès rouge.
This stone will give us red stoneware after firing. From that one, you'll get the brown stoneware zesha, which is the main color for Yixing stoneware.
Celle-ci,
this one, once it's ground, will yield a clay that gives yellow stoneware. And by mixing both stones, we get a kind of greenish stoneware. The rich Yixing stoneware colors range from deep reds, chocolate brown, to precious blacks, or even unexpected golden yellows. This characteristic stoneware, called zesha, has a greater porosity than average to let the teapot breathe better and get better seasoned with time. The more the teapot is used and stained, with successive deposits of tannin contained in the tea, the better the infusion will be. One essential detail of these teapots is that they bear the signature of the potter stamped on their base. This is unique in the history of Chinese arts and crafts, since only major artworks, such as paintings and calligraphies, were generally signed. Hence, the potters of Yixing were not afraid to consider themselves as equals to the brush masters. The fame of masters like Xi Da Bin was such that at the end of the 16th century, his teapots were already worth more than their own weight in gold. Just like this remarkable piece, where we see the mark of the famous potter Xi Da Bin engraved directly in the clay. I felt that I was rediscovering the gestures of the potter mixing the clay, even in some of the restaurants on the street. Whether it's clay used for ceramics or dough to make pasta, the know-how is always brilliant. Wasn't it from this region that Marco Polo brought back spaghetti, which has become the emblem of Italian cuisine? As of the year 1000, during the Song Dynasty, the Yixing kiln production capacity was already at a near-industrial level. The small mounds of potsherds that only a Chinese friend could help me identify gives us some idea of what it must have been like. The many malformations and collage on these pieces are due to firing at too high temperatures. Amongst this debris, we mainly find water recipients, but also a few tea bowls. Pourers, or rather the predecessors of the teapot, were still rare at the time for one simple reason. It was only around 1500 that the method of infusing tea started to spread in China. The manufacture of a specific recipient for this purpose soon became essential. The elite at the time preferred Yixing stoneware teapots to porcelain ones. The trend was set. In the 17th century, European traders also fell under their spell and brought them back to Europe. The Yixing Museum displays precious potsherds of antique teapots of the Song and Ming dynasties, proof of the Chinese people's attachment to the past and present. This museum also offers several other rooms on contemporary designs, with exhibits of the works of praised regional pottery masters. It is in the specialized boutiques of Yixing that one can find the first answers to the teapot manufacturing process. One can buy all the essential tools developed by craftsmen throughout the years. Wooden mallets, cutters, bamboo or iron compasses, horn spatulas for polishing, potter's wheels, and many other items. Generally speaking, and in the old state factories like the Jun Glaze Factory, the Yixing potters prefer the slab construction method to the use of the wheel. Once it is mastered, this original technique is as fast as turning, but it also allows the potter to vary the shapes at will. This approach is the same, regardless of the size of the piece. But the weight of a slab of clay for a large urn is such that it takes two people to move and assemble it. Whatever the originality or the talent of the artist, the shaping process is always the same. It starts with the flooring and throwing of the teapot, and then the spout and handle before the lid and button. There are two main types of teapots, the geometrical, spherical, or cubic ones, and the naturalist ones inspired by fruit, plants, or animals. The diversity of shapes testifies to the exuberant and ever-renewed imagination of the potters. The artists also play with the visual and tactile aspect of the material, as well as with the different decoration techniques. This creativity has always been encouraged by the Asian world's fascination for ceramics, which is so strong that Chinese amateurs will pay fortunes for a piece of a famous potter. In order to maintain the high artistic quality of Yixing's prestigious handmade products, the institutions developed a pyramid-shaped structure topped by the national grandmaster, Go Jingzhou, who died in 1996. Next, there are 6 masters, 54 artists, and a host of apprentices. Each artist has his own style, which often stems from a family tradition. Typically, a Chinese craftsman will utterly copy the ancient masters until he achieves a perfect mastery of the technique. Only then will some of them venture to create their own more personal pieces. The teapots are decorated in various styles. There are the applique designs comprised of one or several colors of earth and gobe, whereby the object is coated in liquid clay and enamel. More specifically, for miniature teapots, the potter follows the rule of the water level, or shui ping, perfectly aligning the tops of the spout and handle with the neck of the teapot. The Gong Fu Sha ceremony is undoubtedly the most sophisticated in the Chinese art of tea. This process of preparing the tea in a stoneware teapot and serving it in porcelain cups, the only cups that allow the drinker to appreciate the beautiful amber color, has existed in China for a long time. It was probably an emperor's decision that launched the fashion for infusing tea. In 1390, the Ming Dynasty Emperor Hong Vo ordered that the tea paid to him as a tribute should no longer be sent to the court in the form of bricks, but simply as roasted leaves. This requirement set off a radical shift from decoction to infusion. It also marked the birth of the teapot. At the end of the 17th century, Europe in turn adopted this same method. The proximity of the former Ming capital Nanjing most probably contributed to the reputation of Yixing teapots. Although for strategic reasons, the imperial palace was transferred and an identical replica built in Beijing, certain members of the dynasty, along with ministers and an entire highly cultivated society, stayed in the ancient city. Today, very little remains of this past splendor, since the imperial palace and the porcelain tower were completely destroyed in the 19th century during the Taiping Revolution. But on the stands of the flea market, a lucky connoisseur may well spot an antique piece, unhurted, from a grave by a farmer or from a nearby worksite by a construction worker. You just need to have an eye for hunting down antiques, and you can come across the best and the worst examples, including mass-produced copies with a patina that has nothing to do with old age. Thanks to places like this, some people like Mr. Cha have built up an impressive collection. This former elite athlete, who has spent most of his savings on his search, agreed to meet me. I started collecting Zesha pottery in 1950. Since then, I've collected over 1,000 pieces, not only teapots, but also vases, jars, and tea jars, because Zesha pottery covers a broad range. I collected most of my pieces in Jiangshou and Zhejiang provinces. In Jiangshou, I found most of them in Nanjing, where you can find a lot of beautiful things because it is one of the old capitals. Today, a lot of good teapots are still made there. The Chinese are becoming richer and richer with the pace of economic development. That means that they have more free time and more money to spend on the teapots, in which they make their national drink, and in particular, on Yixing teapots. We use Yixing teapots every day because they allow the tea leaves to keep their original color, taste, and aroma. They are also of great artistic value. Some old teapots made under the Ming and Qing dynasties, the Kuomintang Republic, and during and after the Cultural Revolution are very valuable for collectors. My 184 favorite pieces from my collection are now on permanent exhibition at the Fine Arts Museum. I wanted to do this to highlight the various aspects of the art of Zecha and Yixing pottery, and especially to allow as many people as possible to enjoy them. The vocation of the Nanjing Museum of Popular Art is to perpetuate traditions like Chinese classical music. Formerly a noble residence of the Qing era, built at the very start of the 19th century, it is now home to Mr. Shah's remarkable donation, much to the delight of museum visitors. This is one of the major pieces in Mr. Shah's collection, and also one of the oldest, dating from the start of the Ming era. There are only two known pieces with this type of lid, where inside there is a clay crosspiece instead of a ring. The first trip to China was marvelous. However, I'd been unable to gather enough information to reconstruct a reliable chronology of Yixing teapots. I set myself the challenge of dating them, and it became a sort of obsession. That was when I had the intuition that the keys to the puzzle lay in Europe.